Welcome to this edition of Excavating the Bible, a program dedicated to exploring the contributions of archaeology in the Middle East to our understanding of and appreciation for the Bible. I'm Doug Clark. I direct the Center for Near Eastern Archaeology at La Sierra University. I'm joined, as we have been conversation partners for many episodes together, Dr. Larry Geraty, Dr. Kent Bramlett, both from La Sierra, both associate directors of the center. And we have been talking about Bible and archaeology. And we are, could we call it a marathon that we're running here?
Right.
Coming to toward the end of our Old Testament books. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. We then will take a few episodes to talk about the time between the Testaments, which most of us feel can help us understand the New Testament better.
Right.
It gives
so
a better
setting for the New Testament. Exactly. We usually skip over it, but it's very interesting.
It's, yeah. Mm-hmm. It's interesting, and some of the literature from that time period between the Testament actually shows up in lots of people's Bibles. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And so, in fact, I understand that at the beginning of the 19th century in the United States, that Bibles were never published without the Apocrypha.
That's true. Mm-hmm.
So they had some insights that typically we don't. And so we'll spend some time there, too. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But we talked this time about the book of Daniel. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I've talked to students in classes often about the two books that if Adventists were ever asked to reduce the Bible down, make it condensed, it would have these two books. One would be Daniel, and the other would be Revelation. Mm-hmm. Because they are what? What genre of literature do they belong to?
We call them apocalyptic, people who are concerned with end times.
Right. And impending danger, mm-hmm, and disaster, mm-hmm, and mm-hmm, destruction. So we have paid attention to those. Our name as a denomination has part of that in it. Mm-hmm. When we think about the second advent, mm-hmm, we're thinking about an apocalyptic event.
Right, and the apocalyptic literature looks through the tumultuous events to final redemption.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And that's something that we can identify with.
Very much so. And so Daniel, so, okay, my question is,
the second half of Daniel is apocalyptic. The first half of Daniel
is more narrative,
is more narrative stories.
Right. Yeah. So when you were a child, Larry, mm-hmm, you certainly were exposed to the book of Daniel.
Oh, yes.
No doubt. I'm going to come to you in a minute, Ken. Okay.
Was and every evangelistic series, right, began with the stories and the prophecies of Daniel and with images of beasts,
right,
and
right,
kings,
right,
and so on.
Yeah. Now, as a child, did you like the stories more than the beasts?
Definitely.
Okay, and as evangelism, as Adventist evangelism, mm-hmm, go forward, mm-hmm, is it more the beasts than the stories, or?
Only the beasts as they come as a part of the last,
sure,
visions of the,
sure,
yeah.
Maybe, though, with the book of Daniel, because of the health, mm-hmm, the healthful eating habits of Daniel, mm-hmm, and his friends. Mm-hmm. That certainly is an important,
yeah,
draw,
mm-hmm,
for
mm-hmm,
Adventists to read it too. So, okay, Kent, where did you start out with the book of Daniel?
Well, probably in the midst of young childhood, certainly the stories of the,
right,
first part.
Right.
The fiery furnace, Daniel in the lion's, mm-hmm, den, Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel at each stage, mm-hmm, his ministry and mission. But the beast, I always liked the horns of the beast. They seemed enigmatic and very interesting.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And the references to time are also very intriguing. I remember, mm-hmm, particularly in high school, academy, I was fascinated with the time periods.
Figuring all those out.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, we are going to be thinking about the book of Daniel and what archaeology can contribute. Is there any biblical book about which there has been more debate about time of writing?
Probably not, right?
Probably not. Mm-hmm. So what are the options? What are the basic two options for?
Well, we know when Daniel lived, according, right, to the stories and, right, so on, and the kings that are mentioned. And, right, so he was taken captive by the Babylonians and ended up in Babylon, and then grew into a prominent position, But then was carried on into the early Persian period when he got along fine with the early Persian kings. So we know fairly precisely when Daniel lived and who he's involved with.
Right. Yeah. Okay, so that would lead many people, certainly in the more traditional interpretations,
right,
to put the book of Daniel then. Mm-hmm. So other scholars do something else. Why is that?
And well, where did they put it? Especially the latter part of Daniel would be incomprehensible to any reader, I would think, who is reading about the story.
In the 6th century?
Right. Mm-hmm. And so there, they're dealing with the features of the 2nd, 3rd century, you know, B.C. And so it seems like the tradition of the early stories are applied in these visions and dreams.
And they're certainly held together. This is a cohesive book.
Right, right.
And so there's something that's allowing the stories to feed, to prepare for, to inform, to influence these apocalyptic visions and so on.
Even when you get down to chapter 11 and 12, there are people who apply that to events of today.
Right.
You know,
right.
They're still looking for a way to make sense of
passages. Well, and I think maybe those of us who've had kind of the longer experience, Kent, you're a young man, so this may or may not apply to you. But we think about all of the applications over our lifetime of chapter 11 and who it is that we plug into those slots. But what you're saying is that maybe if we kind of pay a little bit of attention to the second century, that maybe we'll see what people would have automatically and easily identified. So Kent, the two dates, 6th century and what, middle of the 2nd century?
Early, middle, 2nd century. A lot of people, especially you have the whole progression, the Persians, Greece. I mean, this is spelled out very explicitly in Daniel. And then it sort of stretches into much greater detail just past that. And historically, a lot of people have seen that as describing the wars and tensions between the two powers that controlled Palestine, or we bounced back and forth between them, the Seleucids and the Ptolemies.
It can't be too late in the second century because copies of the Book of Daniel have been found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. Right. And we know that those date from the 3rd century BC down into, you know, Christian times. So I think that it's best dated where it makes the most sense to readers, don't you think?
Mm-hmm. Now, do copies of Daniel, I've forgotten how many there are in the Dead Sea Scrolls.
There are at least 3 or 4.
I'm thinking 4. Mm-hmm. There may be more, but now do any of those date early? Typically, we put the Isaiah Scrolls as probably
the
3rd century.
Earliest.
Do any of the Daniel Scrolls go that early?
I think it's a matter of discussion. There's nothing that I think is definitely, you know, provable. So it's there are discussions about where the handwriting fits best, the paleography and so on. Yeah.
And so what we want to do is, as we did as we did with the Book of Joel, without prejudice to one date or the other, let's see what archaeology says about both, and maybe that will help us actually open some new windows of discovery on both of those options. Before we do that, we have some artifacts, as we always do, on the table. Kent, you're always on the beginning side here, so
it's a good
tell
place
us what's
to be
in front of you.
At this end, we have not ancient artifacts, but artifacts nonetheless. The shofar, the ram's horn, it's simply the hollow, the outer part of a ram's horn, indeed, and by blowing on the small end, you can...
Do you want to illustrate?
I was going to say, well.
I hit and miss, and it's usually miss on these. They're kind of hard.
They are.
Maybe
they
a real trumpeter would be able to. And we have just an example of a simple wind instrument here.
Right, right. And then in front...
What are those?
These are very special, and all of us could tell about these, but they are exact replicas in bronze of two little symbols the same size that we excavated at Tell el-Umeri. And they were important. Others have been found at other sites in Israel, but they were certainly utilized in cultic worship and in ritual.
Why would we put these musical instruments out on a table dealing with Daniel?
Well, we do have references to a number of instruments.
We do.
Repeated references.
Repeated.
Because they're all played to bring about a response to the leader. Mm-hmm. And you should be bowing down to Nebuchadnezzar. Mm-hmm. You should be doing this. And you should do so at the sound of the, and then the bagpipe, right, and the lyre, and the
cymbals.
And so these things are.
There's a whole orchestra mentioned. And
it is.
In fact, there's a Greek, a word that comes from Greek, symphonia, that is mentioned in Daniel.
Right.
That is a Greek loan word, isn't
exactly.
it, in Hebrew.
Yeah. In fact, some people have suggested at least some of these instruments, which don't, the words don't seem to show up elsewhere in the Hebrew Bible, that may be one of those suggestions leading to a later date. And especially the Greek influence and so on. But in any case, we have musical instruments. We've seen them before, but some of these are fairly unique in the text. Mm-hmm. Larry, what else do we have in front of us?
Well, we have the ceramic vessels that we often do. These all seem to deal with liquid all the way here. And then the series of lamps that we've talked about before. These are the bowl forms that are pinched to leave room for the wick. And this is the filler holes. And these two would be a new form that comes in.
The mold form.
The mold form, that's right. And in the bottom and top half are made in molds separately, and then they're put together.
So these forms, we would date to the Persian period. So if we're thinking the early time, certainly when what the story depicts
is
clearly early. Mm-hmm. So we'd think about that. The lamps are getting later, though.
Later.
They're aiming toward the
Hellenistic period.
Hellenistic. So we're talking about the Greek period.
We've also got this clay inscription that sometimes we call a clay tablet. And it has cuneiform on it, which would be at home in Babylon. And I think that you're going to show pictures of some of the literature that comes from Mesopotamia, from Babylon, from the Babylonian kings that are preserved similarly.
Right. Yeah. We have handwriting on the wall in Daniel. Mm-hmm. This isn't a wall.
Right.
But we do have archaeologically the Chronicles of Nabonidus. A king not mentioned in Daniel,
but
whose
son is
Belshazzar, or Belshazzar, is that what you said?
They're contemporary.
That's correct. That's correct. And then a couple of stone pieces here, rather crude. They're portions of weights. So we're going to read in Daniel about weights in the handwriting on the wall. I think the question in interpreting Daniel, and I'm not an expert in apocalyptic literature, is whether mini tekel upharsin is an attempt to be nouns, okay, these weights, or are they verbs in terms of being weighed? And maybe they could be both. I don't know. Again, I'm not an expert in that literature and that part of the text. So we have some weights, and we will be looking at those too. So then let's turn to the book and think about what this book of Daniel is about. And what we're going to do is talk first about 6th century. That's certainly the setting. And if the book is written there, then it's for that too. And then we'll talk about the 2nd century BC.
And First chapter of Daniel specifically mentions that he was taken captive during the time of Jehoiakim, the first Judean king.
In the third year.
In the third year.
That's right. Mm-hmm. So, who else is on that side, Larry?
Well, Jehoiakim had a very short reign. He was put on the throne by a competing king, and then Zedekiah was at the end. The last king of Judah, and then come the governors that take us down to through the Persian period.
And so, if we're thinking about Daniel, and as the story lays out his life, we're talking about pretty much that
all
whole chart.
That's right. That's right. Yeah.
Kent, what do we have on the right side here?
Well, we have the chronology of some of the later prophets, Jeremiah. Right. Of course, we know a lot about Ezekiel during the exile, Obadiah.
So we've seen this before.
We have.
Daniel is here highlighted because that's where we would put Daniel in terms of his life, and again, perhaps, and maybe well, in the writing of the book.
We don't stop to think about Jeremiah and Daniel being contemporaries, do we?
Because, not often.
But they were.
Yeah, yeah. Well, their literature is quite different.
Well, there is.
Which maybe we should pause at this minute to think about why, what makes something apocalyptic and what makes something prophetic? Mm-hmm. How would we think about those?
Apocalyptic is very concerned with the end times. Mm-hmm. The prophets were concerned with their own times. and the faithfulness of people in observing God's expectations for them. But in apocalyptic, you get very intrigued with figuring out what's going to happen in the future.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. They're both, in a way, messages for the present. But
they are.
With apocalyptic, the resolution is right. In the far distant future.
Right. Right. Right.
Whereas a lot of prophetic work promises resolution
immediately
or with the change of heart.
And even mm-hmm. on a grander scale.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when the prophets, typically the prophetic literature, the Amoses, mm-hmm. the Isaiahs, and so on, when they talk about a future that is bright and glorious and mm-hmm. wonderful, it's typically this worldly,
mm-hmm.
and it's typically,
reach.
It is within reach, mm-hmm. and it's what many people call an ideal future.
Mm-hmm.
And it's great. I mean, it's the best. It's peaceful.
Mm-hmm.
It's times of prosperity. The crops are growing well. Mm-hmm. The flocks are doing well.
You're turning plowshares into, or
swords into plowshares. And everybody's building their right. own house mm-hmm. and living and eating mm-hmm. from their own vine.
Mm-hmm.
Apocalyptic presses that into a cosmic scale.
Mm-hmm.
And does so with great fanfare.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean that in a very positive sense. I mean, it's a way of saying to people in the present, there is something better, and it's going to be more glorious than you can imagine.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And maybe a lot of blood and violence in the meantime.
It's worth remaining faithful for.
Right, right.
And at least the people who put together the Hebrew Bible thought of Daniel not as listed among the prophets.
Right.
Even though in English Bibles, Daniel shows up with the listing of the prophets.
Mm-hmm.
Where does Daniel show up in the Hebrew Bible?
In the writings.
Mm-hmm. In the collection of mm-hmm. writings. So there was a sense that there is something different about
mm-hmm.
this.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't take away anything from authority
right.
or message, but it certainly adds a dimension
mm-hmm.
and when
mm-hmm.
we think about it this way.
Mm-hmm.
I think some people have said who would say that the book perhaps is later mm-hmm. in its final edition, is that it apocalyptic is beginning to rise.
Mm-hmm.
It's not something that has really jumped out early in the Old Testament. Mm-hmm. There are certainly apocalyptic
passages.
Sections, right,
mm-hmm.
But nothing like a whole book. So
mm-hmm.
anyway, the debate goes on, mm-hmm. and we'll think about that. But let's move to some kings here. If we were thinking Daniel 6th century, there are the kings. We've seen these before, Babylon and Persia. But if we go to the 2nd century, what do we have going on here, Ken?
Wow, this is a very different world. This is the beginning of the Hasmonean independent Jewish kingdom, but it's the very beginning. It's the transition with the revolt of the Maccabeans against the Hellenistic
rule.
Okay,
now you've mentioned some Hasmoneans and some Maccabeans. Where would you go to read about this history?
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh.
That intertestamental literature.
Intertestamental
called the
literature.
Apocrypha, except that some of the books of Maccabees are quite historical.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, right, right. So who's in rulership positions?
Well, it is the Judeans, the...
How long, then, do we have some kind of independence here?
About 100 years.
It's about a century.
Very close, actually.
Isn't it? So if we put Daniel in this context,
mm-hmm.
in terms of the writing of the book,
mm-hmm.
not the stories,
mm-hmm.
but the writing, and then who's around? Who's surrounding us, Larry?
Well, these are the successors to Alexander the Great when his empire was divided up.
Mm-hmm.
The Antiochus and the Seleucids and a couple of other generals of his divided up his empire. But it's the Antiochus and the Seleucids that interest, or the Ptolemies too, down in Egypt,
right.
are figure into biblical history.
Okay, there's a name here that is quite definitive for people who want to think of second century as the final putting of the book together. And who is that?
Antiochus the Great, who desecrated the temple.
Yes, yes. Otherwise known as Epiphanes. Mm-hmm. So what does that word mean? That's a Greek term. What does it mean?
Somebody who reveals something.
The appearance of
shiny. Like a deity. Is it? Does it have to do with being lustrous and shiny? Is that how? I've seen people translate this as Antiochus the Shiny One. And I don't know how far that goes to whether that's a person that liked them or not. But in any case, actually, I think that was in the mouths of. Well, actually, we're told that people, when they were asked to bow down to Antiochus Epiphanes, they muttered his name slightly differently. Instead of the Shining One, Antiochus Epimenes, the Madman. Mm-hmm. And he does what? What's the desecration that happens?
Well, there was some pushback against the Hellenism. How much should Jews adopt of the Hellenistic culture? When Antiochus the Fourth Epiphanes went down all the way into Egypt to fight against the Ptolemies there, there was a rumor that he had died. So some of the people in Jerusalem celebrated. The problem was he wasn't dead.
No,
he came back. He
was
furious at that.
That was premature.
That was premature. So he sacrificed a pig in the temple, and this then began the revolt, the desecration of the temple in Jerusalem.
In 167?
167 began the resistance, the revolt by first a family, the Maccabean family.
Right.
And eventually, against all odds, they won independence against the Hellenistic states.
167, the desecration of the temple with the sacrifice of the pig, that gets resolved in, is it December-ish of 164? In fact, I think it's fairly precise, which leads to the celebration of what?
The Festival of Lights, of Hanukkah.
Of lights and of Hanukkah. Mm-hmm.
You know, in what, the book of John, Jesus goes up to Jerusalem to celebrate this feast.
Right. So if we're thinking second century, this would be the connection that most people, certainly the scholars who put it here, would make. If we're thinking geopolitics of the sixth century, we've seen these before, Babylonian Empire, and then expanded more broadly, the Persian Empire. If we are thinking geopolitics of the second century, we are imagining something more. Well, we're still thinking Mediterranean, but now we have this dispersion. Kent, you talked about the, or maybe it was about the, with the death of Alexander the Great, the dispersion of the kingdom into what, four different parts?
Four different ones.
And so the Seleucids were Syria and north and east, and the Ptolemies, Egypt. And so this map illustrates that fairly well. And in Judea, The map of what we call the Holy Land keeps changing, doesn't it?
It does.
It's shrinking during the Persian period. It's now expanding. And under, as you mentioned, Kent, under Jewish control.
Yeah, it's a large area compared to most of the Old Testament period.
And then someone is going to bring an end to Jewish control. Maybe the Romans.
Right, 63 BC.
Right.
The black lines are the pre-1967 borders of Israel. So by comparison, you can see
the
modern Israel and the ancient Israel
would look like.
Right.
Outline. What are these stories about? We've actually talked a bit about
faithfulness, really, isn't it?
It's faithfulness.
Faithfulness in the face of persecution and trial.
Now, it is, as much of the later literature, much of the literature from the Persian period involves engagement with world empires at a personal level. And Daniel's engagement is to be in the positions of power and leadership, to be among these leaders and to influence them. Esther, in a similar way, Esther's late. We've got other responses. Some of them stay away from the foreigners entirely. So there are different kinds of responses. Daniel is one of them. Be faithful wherever you are, whether it's in what you eat, what you're listening to, where you're going. It is an attempt to be faithful, even under trying circumstances. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then we have the apocalyptic one, the apocalyptic section. So you notice in chapter 8, the sanctuary polluted. And of course, that's an important chapter for Adventists as we think about the apocalyptic vision that has been created and confirmed and continued to think about in terms of our own future. Mm-hmm. Daniel is significant and central to that. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we pay attention. Okay, so we have some archaeological issues to deal with. We talk about if we want to go with the 6th century, if we want to go with the 2nd century. We have dreams and dream interpretation. There actually is quite a bit about that. But I think we're going to look more at what we have busts of leaders and so on. Mm-hmm. So, Nebuchadnezzar, how accurate do we think this is?
Well, it's stylized, isn't it? But, I mean, it was clearly, these were could be contemporary with Nebuchadnezzar. So there could be a facial representation.
Right. Nabonidus, the one who does not show up in the Hebrew Bible, in the biblical book, but does show up elsewhere. And we're going to look at a couple of texts tied to Nabonidus.
And all the kings from Nabonidus, from Nebuchadnezzar down to Nabonidus and his son Daniel lived through that whole period.
Right, yeah. Right. A long lifespan. Mm-hmm. So we have some weights and musical instruments. I'm going to show a couple of those. We've actually seen them, so we'll not linger here. The Egyptians drew musical instruments a lot. A lyre, that's one of the instruments that shows up in this section. Mm-hmm. And maybe the earliest representation of a bagpipe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Romans took it up to England, it ended up in Scotland, and
when they occupied Palestine, the British reintroduced it. So now, the Nabonidus text. This one, the Chronicle, which comes from the 6th century, and Kent, just a quick word about, we don't have a lot of time, but a quick word about the content. Well,
the contemporaries thought Nabonidus was a bit crazy. At some point in his reign, he was a devotee of Sin, the moon god, and he eventually went off to the oasis of Tema in Arabia and left his son, regent in Babylon.
Belshazzar.
But, so the people thought he was crazy, and he neglected the worship of Marduk and actually took the image out of Babylon. And that was then what Cyrus used as the legitimization of his capture of Babylon.
Right. Now, if we go to the 2nd century, we have the prayer of Nabonidus. And we may have just enough time for you to read that, Larry.
Words of the prayer said by Nabonidus, king of Babylonia the Great, when afflicted with an ulcer on command of the Most High God in Tema.
That's sounding a bit like the Nebuchadnezzar story, too.
Nabonidus was afflicted with an evil ulcer for 7 years. Far from men I was driven until I prayed to the Most High God. And an exorcist pardoned my sins. He was a Jew from among the children of the exile of Judah and said, and this is what he said.
Thank you, Larry. Thank you, Kent. And thank all of you for joining us for this edition of Excavating the Bible. We may need to come back and think about this text and its significance, but it's great, and thank you for reading it. Thank you for joining us. Join us next time.